Okay, pretty dwarves took turns doing handstands on the carpet. D3 or D3.js is a free open source JavaScript library for visualizing data. Its low-level approach built on web standards offers unparalleled flexibility in authoring dynamic data-driven graphics. For more than a decade, blah 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 awards, blah blah blah. D3 is not a charting library in the traditional sense, it has no concept of charts. To make a stacked area chart, you might use a CSV parser to load data, a time scale for horizontal position, a linear scale for vertical position. Can we just stay here and appreciate the fact that there is a separate module for X and a separate module for Y? Ordinal scale and categorical scheme for color, blah 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 blah. D3 is not a single monolith, but rather a suite of 30 discrete libraries. We recommend exploring the documentation and examples to get a sense of what is relevant to you. And then they give you this. I have to make it smaller here for it to fit. Yeah, smaller, 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 smaller. I get this 50 Shades of Grey moment, kind of, where I'm just like, I don't want to make any decisions. Just tell me what to do. But you know, it's fine. We're gonna start with the first example that we see. That, by the way, is gonna be principle one of this course. It's going to be sequential. It's not going to be the optimal sequence of course topics, but it's going to be a sequence of course topics. We're going to pick one, a path. So we're going to go to getting started here. And this is a blank chart. I love myself a blank chart. And this is the code to generate a blank chart. I mean, it's... I'm making fun of it, but it's not too bad. But still though, if you look at, say, the area chart example here later in the docs, this is a full chart, not an empty one, but and it just has a little bit more code. But if we scroll down here, we see some example code that does the same area chart, but using the higher level library observable plot. And this piece of code, this is basically nothing. And if this piece of code, observable plot, seems a little bit more up your alley, I have a video that goes in that direction over here, over there. In this series though, we are going into D3, which is for bespoke visualization. If you need maximal expressiveness for your bespoke visualization, then you should consider D3. To paraphrase Amanda Cox, Amanda Cox is a data journalist at Bloomberg News, by the way, use D3 if you think it's perfectly normal to write 100 lines of code for a bar chart. So at this point, it's good to ask ourselves, what the hell are we getting into? I had a psychologist that always said that if you are doing something challenging, it's always good to take a step back to your values and reflect on why you're doing something in order to galvanize your resolve. I can't say why you want to learn D3, but I can say why I want to learn D3. I really like understanding the fundamentals of things. Fun function has always been about fundamentals. It's part of the fun. It's about understanding the ground that we are walking on. Almost all data visualization frameworks seem to build on top of D3. Even pretty general visualization grammar like Vega, for instance. And I figure that they build on D3 for good reasons. And I like to learn what those reasons are. And maybe someday we want to build our own data visualization framework on top of D3, or maybe we use one a lot and we want to get a good feel for why it works the way it does. Another thing about this is that Mike Bostock and the wonderful people that built D3, they're talented people, but they're not alien wizards, you know? They're normal people, just like us, that has constructed these things, and getting a little bit into how it all is put together, and maybe building our own libraries with it, and maybe poking a little bit in the source code, that can be very good for our self-efficacy. Defying gravity a bit, if you understand what I mean. So, how are we going to approach this? We are going to divide and conquer. And by that, I mean that I'm gonna identify one bit of D3, one isolated bit, and then make one video about that bit. And then we're gonna repeat that a hojillion kabillion times. If we do that right, it's gonna be a little cliffhanger at the end of every episode, including this one. And that is the second principle of the Dirty D3 series. Kinda, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. And I figured that we'd just start by jumping into the docs, into getting started. So look at this blank chart. Love myself a blank chart and this empty plot here. And then we look at the example code here and we walk through it down until we find something that confuses us. So, well, this is a bunch of constants that define the chart dimensions and the margins with height, margin to margin, right margin. And then we have this. Declare the horizontal position, scale its x, and then D3 scale UTC. Then we have a dot domain call and a new date and a call to a range method. I don't know what any of this is, so I'm going to try to find the docs for D3.scaleUTC and see if that helps. Okay, it's on the documentation page for time scales. Time scales are a variant of linear scales that have a temporal domain. Okay, so I got confused halfway into the first sentence there by linear scales. So we're not going to go further on this page, but instead I'm going to keep on dividing and conquering and drill down into a smaller and therefore less scary subject. So we're going to see what linear scales are. Linear scales map a continuous quantitative input domain to a continuous output range using a linear transformation. Okay, so we are looking at this D3.scaleLinear here. Scale linear. I remember seeing that in the original example. So hang on. Here. So the Y scale code here is actually simpler than the X scale code because it's a simpler type of scale, which makes sense when you think about it. If we look here at the X axis, that's a time scale, while the Y axis is just a numerical scale. And time in programming is, as everybody knows, super duper bullshit. And this, we are going to skip over the x-axis definition for now. Yes, our brains won't explode today. So in the next episode, that is coming right up if you're watching this from the future, we're going to be tackling D3.scaleLinear.